So today we finish up what I have nicknamed the Dark Trilogy with our look at Dark Flow and the Great Attractor. We previously looked at dark matter in the first episode, and then dark energy. And as I said back when we began looking at these three phenomena, they do not have too much in common besides the word dark. Much like the term the dark side of the moon, which refers to the side we can't see, not how much light it gets, dark is used to mean a thing which we cannot see or otherwise detect. Also this week, we are doing a collaboration episode with fellow YouTuber Joe Scott, who will be looking at the Great Attractor. And you can click over to that video now if you like. This video will just pause and open his in a new window, or at the end of the episode when I'll bring the link back up again. It will also be linked down in the video description for those of you watching from platforms that don't allow in-video links. If you are visiting from Joe's channel and are new here, I suggest you turn on the closed captions for this episode, as my speech impediment can take a little getting used to. Okay, so what is dark flow? As you know, just about everything outside our galaxy and its nearest neighbors is moving away from us. And the further away they are, the faster they are moving. Indeed, as we discussed in the dark energy video, that expansion seems to be accelerating too, so that it looks like a trillion years down the road, almost all the universe we can reach will be within a million or so light years of us, even though the observable universe will be trillions of light years wide, and most of what is in the currently observable universe will have sailed over the horizon, leaving us alone in an immense void. The speed things move away from us from the Hubble expansion is proportional to their distance from us, get twice as far away, and the velocity is twice as high. So anything already at galactic distances moving away from us will just keep moving away faster and faster. But things do not have an exact velocity based solely on their distance from us. Much like everything else, they move relative to each other. So two galaxies nearby each other might be moving away from us at a rate of 1,000 kilometers a second, but one is only moving away at, say, 990 km, and the other at 1,010 km. We would expect that, same as the moons around Mars or Jupiter keep pace with their planets, but might be moving toward us a bit or away from us a bit while performing their own orbits. Galaxies tend to exist in clumps too, so it is no surprise some might be moving toward us or away from us, relative to their cluster, even if that cluster is receding away from us, much as a bus driving by your home might have people walking up and down the aisles. These are local motions, and we would expect them to all average out. Indeed, we almost have to assume that, since our main way to determine the distance of very distant objects is to look at how fast they are moving away from us by their redshift. If we saw those two galaxies from a moment ago, we might not even realize at first that they were near each other, just in the same direction, because we are guessing their distance from their velocities, their redshift, and they are not the same. It can be quite difficult to look at a group of galaxies and figure out what each one's velocity relative to that area is, what is called their peculiar velocity. In this sense, we use the word peculiar not to mean strange or odd. We'll get to the strange and odd motion in a moment, but in its other meaning, of something belonging exclusively to. In fact, that is the original meaning, and it meaning strange or odd came later. Much as I might say that cliff diving is a hobby I consider peculiar to those sorts of people who like their hobbies suicidally reckless, and how we might say those people are a bit strange, and so peculiar in that way too. But I digress. We use the term peculiar velocity to refer to a thing's velocity when we cut away the component from Hubble expansion, so we can talk about how a group of galaxies move relative to each other. Now, we would expect that to average out to zero, so it came as a bit of a surprise in 2008 when we noticed a lot of galaxies seemed to be moving, in terms of peculiar velocity, in a specific direction. They were flowing that way for no apparent reason, presumably from a source of gravity we could not see. This gave us the term dark flow. First, the motion is headed toward a place we called the Great Attractor, having already noticed all the way back in the 1970s that galaxies in our supercluster were drifting that way. Irritatingly, the Great Attractor happens to be in the Zone of Avoidance, whose somewhat dramatic sounding name probably helped add to the mystery value with the public. It is a huge chunk of the night sky, taking up about 20% of it. The Zone of Avoidance sounds like a place you would expect to be where space pirates hung out, or maybe some evil galactic empire. It used to be called the Zone of Few Nebulae, which isn't much better because now it sounds like some empty place Cthulhu would go for naps. However, nebulae is what we used to call other galaxies. As I mentioned back in the Dark Matter episode, we confused them with nebula in our own galaxy and didn't realize how far away and huge they were. This was a zone of the sky in which few were found. You could also consider the zone of avoidance the second zone of avoidance, since telescopes can rotate any which way, but you usually want to avoid pointing them down at the ground. If you don't avoid pointing your telescope at the ground, you won't see many stars. The zone of avoidance is just a term that refers to the chunk of the sky our galaxy occupies, and all the stars and dust make it quite difficult to see distant galaxies on the other side of it. Hence, you avoid looking at that zone if you want to study distant galaxies. In that respect, it is not too surprising that the Great Attractor lies in that direction. 20% of the universe lies in that direction, after all. Now, when this first got noticed back in the 1970s, the assumption was that there was probably a lot of matter we couldn't see over there. Some folks took "we can't see it" to imply it must be some giant supercolossal black hole. But again, the lack of visibility is because our own galaxy is in the way. The main assumption was there was just a ton of galaxies in that direction. That was interesting at the time because we had still been assuming the universe was pretty evenly spread, not all clumped together into lines and walls and huge voids. Whichever the case, as the years rolled by, there were arguments about the method and how much mass was actually there, which was kind of difficult to rigorously measure with us not being able to see the stuff closest to it to take measurements either. It is estimated to be around 200 million light years away, which is very far away though also quite close on the scale of the observable universe. The observable universe is a couple hundred times wider than the volume encompassing our galaxy and the Great Attractor, and several million times bigger in terms of mass and volume. In 2008 though, we got new data and we saw that there seemed to be a much larger volume of space moving toward this spot. For a while, some were even thinking the whole universe might be headed in that direction, and that the Great Attractor might not be some spot a couple hundred million light years away, but actually billions of light years away, possibly outside the observable universe. And that's allowable too. The observable universe is not the whole universe, just those parts we can see. And we have no idea how big the whole universe is. It may indeed be infinite. It may just be a little bit bigger than the observable part. But the main assumption is that it is at least much, much larger than what we can see. If the universe didn't start off very evenly spread, there could have been a super huge chunk of mass just over the cosmological horizon in some direction, causing a drift. Now, gravity does move at the speed of light. For some reason, I still hear folks say it is instantaneous, and I have no idea where that comes from. Though amusingly, if you think of gravity as being made of gravitons, in the same way light is made of photons, that does raise some eyebrows about how gravity itself escapes from black holes. So no mass that's already fled over the cosmological horizon is exerting force on us anymore. The cosmological horizon is the imaginary line where space is expanding faster than the speed of light, so no light from galaxies beyond that ever reaches us again, and also no gravity. That does not mean it was not pulling on us in the past, or is not pulling on things nearer to it, causing a net drift or flow. Now, this stored a lot of speculation and ideas, but before you go off contemplating those, not only was dark flow at the universal scale never particularly accepted, it more or less got skewered in 2013 when we got the data back from the ESA's Planck Space Telescope. It showed no evidence of dark flow on the universal scale. This does not mean dark flow was debunked, because it is just a term for large-scale flow of galaxies in some direction where that direction cannot be seen well enough to get too specific about the cause. And by cause, I mean the source of the gravity. I am not implying some weird new force or phenomena. It would not be limited to just our area of the universe and the Great Attractor, but by and large, those flows at very distant locations won't be dark to us, since we won't be sitting in the middle of the flow, with its center obscured by our galaxy being in the way. At the same time, I do not want to imply this is not a mystery, or that it is not important. It is both. In fact, in recent years, you may have heard the emergence of the term the Laniakea supercluster. This is our supercluster of galaxies that we live in. You might not be familiar with it because we used to call our supercluster the Virgo supercluster, but the emerging evidence would seem to point to it just being a decent-sized chunk of a larger construct, including a few more superclusters, all centered around the Great Attractor. The Laniakea supercluster, our new supercluster, centered on the Great Attractor, is 500 million light years across and contains a total mass of around 10,000 trillion times our own sun's mass. That's many thousands of galaxies and many hundreds of galaxy clusters. The name derives from Hawaiian and means immense heaven, presumably because it is impolite to name everything in Greek, although more likely because we are running out of Greek words we haven't already used for something else. Now, when we say things are moving toward it, they actually are not. They are mostly moving away from it, but not as fast as they should be. As a rule, galactic superclusters are too far spread out not to be ripped apart by the expansion of the universe. Regular galactic clusters are not, so our neighboring galaxies ought to stay with us till the end of time and eventually merge with us. Which they do all the time anyway. This last week's big science news was astronomers discovering there were 10 times as many galaxies as previously thought, and I got messaged dozens of times about it by folks wondering if it tossed dark matter and dark energy into the trash can. It did not. This is an example of way too much hype in science journalism. We already knew our galaxy, like many of the bigger modern galaxies, had gobbled up tons of smaller neighbors. Our galaxy is a big cannibal gobbling up its neighbors. In fact, it is probably not our galaxy, as it looks like we might have originated with the late Sagittarius dwarf galaxy. Everybody knows about the large and small Magellanic clouds, our two dwarf satellite galaxies. But as we learn more, we can see the gutted carcasses of an awful lot of them floating around in us or near us. Over 50 that have been identified, though some are disputed, and there could be more we ate so long ago we cannot see the traces. The big new discovery was a big discovery, but it was of the finally some proof variety, not oh my god our theories are in ruins variety. They found a lot of dwarf galaxies when they looked far away in space, and thus also far back in time. It was confirmation of what was expected, that there were a lot of smaller, dimmer galaxies in the ancient universe, most of which have merged together in modern times. They are going to keep merging too, as the eons meander along, till you do not have a galactic cluster anymore, just single big galaxies, bigger than now, floating alone in the void, with huge and ever-increasing distances to their neighboring galaxies. This is the confusion we see with the Great Attractor. Again, it is not that all these galaxies are moving toward it. As I said, they are not. It is probably not moving toward itself either, since it is probably just a bunch of galaxies, maybe slightly more densely packed than normal, or maybe just in the rough center of a fairly large supercluster. Things are moving away from it, but slower than they should be because there is a lot of gravity working against the Hubble expansion, which is presumably caused by dark energy. It does not necessarily mean that this will all be torn apart though, just that if left to itself, it will be. The Great Attractor has become a popular place in science fiction to have some sort of mega-civilization that dwarfs even the galaxy-spanning Kardashev 3 civilizations we discussed in the recent episode on the Kardashev scale. As I mentioned way back in the Black Hole Farming episode, Civilizations at the End of Time, the way we predict the universe to look in a few trillion years will almost certainly not be what it looks like if we ever get out and start colonizing other solar systems or anyone else has. And as I mentioned in the Kardashev scale episode, you can move galaxies, same as you can move stars. Something we showed in the Shikata Thrusters episode was very effort intensive, but not actually very high tech at all. If it turns out, we have not only this whole galaxy to ourselves, but the whole supercluster, it might make sense for us to race out ahead of the expansion and start shoving galaxies back toward ourselves. We are not at the center of either our traditional Virgo supercluster or the larger Lanakia supercluster we think is centered around the Great Attractor, but with Dark Flow helping bind these things together, it makes it a lot easier to push them to keep them together. So rather than a sphere of galaxies around our own being rescued from Hubble expansion, you might see such a sphere centered more around the Great Attractor, especially if there's a handful of other civilizations living in the area who might want to team up and would probably be evenly distributed throughout it. That is a case where teaming up is good, since you end up with a larger overall number of galaxies than the combined number each would get working on its own. But if we have the place to ourselves, we might as well grab as much of it as we can, and in the same way we might expect a galactic empire to recenter itself from Earth to someplace a bit more central to use as a capital, you might see the same thing happen for the supercluster, and get some multi-galactic empire's capital located in the Great Attractor, controlling tens of thousands of galaxies. I don't think that is terribly likely, especially without at least some form of fast and light communication, if not travel, but I always seem to be in a minority in thinking FTL is not in the cards. So it is good fuel for science fiction authors, perhaps. Beyond the zone of avoidance, deep inside the Great Attractor, lies the seat of an ancient empire ruling over 10,000 galaxies. So that's Dark Flow, the mysterious motion of the galaxies toward the Great Attractor, and it is still a mystery, but hopefully less of one right now. That will also close out our look at dark matter, dark energy, and dark flow. Next week, we will be coming back much closer to home for a look at colonizing the outer solar system, and the week after that, we will be taking a look at some more astronomy to demystify a lot of the terms and concepts like we did today, and look at some of the more bizarre stars in the Stellar Compendium. I'd like to thank Joe Scott from Answers with Joe for teaming up with me on this topic, and if you'd like to hear some more fun stuff about the Great Attractor, you can head on over to his channel to see that now, using the in-video link or the one in the episode description. And you can also come by the Facebook group or subreddit, both titled Science and Futurism with Isaac Arthur, to talk with others about some of these concepts. You can also try out any of the episodes on the playlists on this channel, or over at the website, isaacarthur.net. If you enjoyed this episode, please like it and share it with others. And again, next week is colonizing the outer solar system. And until then, thanks for watching, and have a great day.